Well, once again, so good to be here together, isn't it? To be able to be here on a bright, sunny day. Bright sunshine, strong coffee. This is what I need this morning. So today, of course, is Nehemiah 8. I'm so glad it's not 9 and 10. Nehemiah 8, and that's about covenant renewal and heart renewal. I recently read the story of Mary Rowlandson. And she was a woman living on the frontier. And in her day, living on the frontier meant living in Lancaster, Massachusetts. This was February of 1676 during King Philip's War. And Mary and her family were attacked and carried off into captivity. Several of Mary's extended family died that day. She saw her own home go up in flames. In most of her community. She was separated from the rest of her family on that day except for her six-year-old daughter. And that little girl died in her arms within about 10 days into the time of captivity. Well, some years after her release, Mary wrote an autobiography, and that's entitled A True History of Captivity and Restoration. So Mary was a woman with strong faith, strong Puritan faith, and she often mentions in her writing that scripture helped her to not to lose her mind and not to lose her hope. I was especially interested in Mary's account of her release and then her return, and she writes about the very mixed emotions that she had during that time. She says, I may well say with the psalm, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, his mercy endures forever. I was full of joy, and yet not without sorrow, deep sorrow. And then even when she was reunited with her husband, she still felt a lot of distress about her home and her community being destroyed. And in fact, it took quite a while for all her children to be able to be released as well. And so she says, we are now in the midst of love, yet not without much and frequent heaviness of heart. So we can see the parallels, can't we, between Mary's situation and the chapter that we're looking at today, Nehemiah 8, because we're reading about people's return from captivity and being restored and experiencing a range of emotions. So like Mary Rowlandson, the Jewish returnees weep and they celebrate. And we also find that knowing the Word of God, just like with Mary, it plays a prominent part in the coming back of these returnees. In fact, we would say that the Word of God is center stage, really, in Nehemiah 8. So let's pray before we start. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for another opportunity to study your holy word. And so please open our hearts to your beauty and to your truth. Let us be renewed, I pray, like the people of Israel. Renew us and reaffirm us in our faith as we look into your word this morning. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so back in Nehemiah 7, that long list of returnees gets repeated, right? So Nehemiah and Ezra went together in the Hebrew Bible. And is back in Ezra 2, that whole list was laid out for the readers, but it got repeated in Nehemiah 7. And that's because the author is really trying to make a theological point at this time. He wants the city repopulated, obviously, but way more important, he really wants these people who are resettling to understand their own spiritual history and their continuity then with their forefathers who also dwelt there in Jerusalem. So throughout their history, you know, these chapters, these books that we've studied in the Old Testament, we've been able to see that throughout their history, we see that the Hebrew people were at their best when they listened to God's word and they lived under his reign. So once again, that possibility is before them. They've returned from captivity. And Nehemiah wants them to know, you're not just in Jerusalem, you're home. And you have the opportunity once more to live as God's people. So our chapter today deals with spiritual restoration for the people. They've rebuilt the wall. They're resituating, you know, in the city and around. They've even done the basic rebuilding of the temple, but something is missing. There's a spiritual vacuum still. And the key to the whole enterprise is the hearts of the people. The hearts of God's people are built and made strong by God's word. That's the bricks and mortar, God's word. So together, we see Nehemiah and Ezra working together in this chapter to create this opportunity for a new beginning. I heard about a church whose slogan was, Second Baptist, a great place for a fresh start. So I think that's what these returnees are being offered at this time. And you know, we can see, just looking at the first verse of Nehemiah 8, that something good is taking hold in Jerusalem, because it says that the people ask Ezra to bring the book of the law and to read it to them. So this is men, women, all who were able to understand came and listened. Verse 3 says their ears were attentive. When it uses a phrase like that, it means not just physical ears, but their hearts and their minds were engaged. So there was Ezra up there. Oops, better not gesture with coffee. Ezra was up there standing on that special platform that they had built, and he begins to read. Back in Ezra 7:10, it records the kind of person that Ezra was. He was a priest, but it says that he set his heart on God's law, set his heart on teaching it to others, and on applying it to his own life. So let's picture Ezra up there on the platform and just think how happy he would have been to have been in that situation. Verses 1 through 3 of our chapter kind of say things in, you know, cut and dried sort of way. But I think we really should be able to imagine Ezra's voice just ringing out with joy when he was able to read as he was that day. So this fresh start and reaffirmation of their faith doesn't take place in a vacuum or in just a feel-good, you know, kind of setting. They're not saying, well, like, hey, we're back. Let's hold some rallies. Let's make Jerusalem great again. No, instead, their rebuilding is built upon God's holy word. Okay, so when people hear God's word, we don't just, you know, sit. Our eyes and our ears are engaged, and it brings forth a response in the people. So in the midst of Ezra's reading, verse 6, it says, he praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, amen, amen. Then they bowed down and they worshiped the Lord with their faces to the ground. Okay, so here we have one of these good biblical examples of why it's perfectly reasonable to express agreement or joy or lament even during worship. We can lift our hands. We can say amen. There's nothing wrong with that. As long as our response is genuine worship and isn't distracting to others, it's allowed. You know, I grew up in a Christian tradition where we knelt to pray, and that wasn't something that seemed showy or pious. It was just that was what we did. And I've been on a retreat overseas where people prayed lying down on the floor. And oddly enough, that didn't seem odd in that context. My sister and her husband were missionaries in Cameroon all of their ministry lives. And in that African country, at offering time, the church members, so there'd be music playing, but the church members would dance up to the altar, present their offerings, dance out the side doors, dance around the church, and then come back in the front door clapping and singing. And that the music would continue that way. So that was perfectly natural. It was a contextual expression of their worship. So it was good and appropriate. So we don't need to be overly careful when our hearts respond or sometimes our eyes respond. Because it says the people said amen, they lift up their hands. Verse 9 says the people also wept as they heard the word of the Lord. Now, we're not told why exactly. Maybe they were remorseful because of all that they lost because of their disobedience. Maybe they were confessing sin at that time, or maybe they were just weeping out of relief at knowing that God had not forgotten them. So we're not told, but any of the above might be true. Weeping can also be a genuine part of a response. I'm a communion crier. So many times during communion, just there come the tears welling up. Okay, so verse 7 also has an interesting point. Ezra brought a teaching team with him. He brought 13 guys, it says, and we're not even going to try to pronounce their names, but these men were likely teachers from amongst the priests and the scribes. So this is a thing. It's been ages since the people have heard this, and he didn't expect them to understand completely. So according to verses 7 and 8, these teachers, leaders, circulated among the people during the reading and helped them to understand, to not get overwhelmed, and to learn. So right there, the people could ask questions, they could get answers. This is just a great idea. You know, I don't know what our services would be like if we could be in a pew and ask somebody to come over and could you explain, you know, what the guy up front just said. But anyway, it's a great idea. It's really being concerned about their heart understanding. And, you know, I couldn't help but be impressed with their ability to stand and listen for this many hours, for one thing. Maybe that's why they were crying. That's what probably the cynics among us would say. But I couldn't help but be impressed with their desire to hear God's word and to know God better. And I feel like I wanted to share about a couple in the area where I grew up who helped me and helped many, many high school students to have a desire to learn about God's word and to really know God through his word. That couple is John and Bev Burnham, and they were just salt of the earth kind of people. They lived in a big ranch house in Morton, Illinois, and had a big old finished basement. And as they thought about this, they thought, well, we're going to invite kids from our church to start off with because we really want them to, you know, love and understand the Bible. And we'll just say, invite your friends. Well, the first time I was there, there's probably 70 kids in the basement of John and Bev Burnham's house. And I don't even remember them serving food. I mean, that's an unusual thing. It's just like we went there because we were hungry for God's word. Because that's the atmosphere that they created. Where the Bible is read, God speaks. And kids' lives were changed. My life was changed. Remember, I've told you I grew up in the Jesus People era, and I believe that in that, you know, basement at John and Bev's house that we actually experienced some of that awakening. I'm so grateful for that couple. Okay, well, back to the weepy people. They were told by Nehemiah and Ezra, don't weep anymore. Don't weep anymore. This day is holy to the Lord. So go back home. This is like verses 9 through 12. Go back home, and actually we want you to celebrate. And eat the choicest foods, good stuff to drink, and make sure that you share with those who don't have the same resources that you do. So particularly verse 10, that's the standout verse in this chapter because it's famous and it's just one of those that really stays in our hearts and our minds. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. So in these verses where they're told not to weep now, but to celebrate and to know this joy that's from the Lord, what deep truth is being communicated here? I think we can assume that the people, you know, they're instructed to go to celebrate, and what they're celebrating then at that point is that God had not forsaken them. He'd never forsaken them, and that he's still speaking to them through his word. They are his people. So they're supposed to rejoice in those truths about God and be strengthened. So to recap, Nehemiah has been leading this 52-day construction project, right? And then he's joined by Ezra, who reads, and the leaders to explain. And then the people respond. They respond with reverence, with worship, with weeping, and with a transformation of their priorities. So where did I get that idea, the transformation of their priorities? Well, it looks to me like they have new interest, because verse 13, the second day of the seventh month, actually, so the most of this chapter takes place in 2 days' time. The second day of the seventh month, the fathers, like the heads of the households, the priests, the Levites, again got together. I mean, the day before wasn't enough. Again got together, and they gathered around Ezra, it says. And together, they looked into God's word, and they noticed something together, that there was an important festival for them to celebrate. And it was supposed to take place right at that time, right at the beginning of the seventh month. There's a festival that remembers and celebrates God's protection over them during their years in the wilderness. So you can just see him kind of huddled around Ezra there, and it's like, well, look, guys, it looks like we're supposed to go out into the hillsides, collect these branches, and bring them back in order to build these leafy tent-like structures that remind us of how we lived in the wilderness with God's protection over us. So, new instructions. How did they respond to this new instruction? They responded with joyful obedience. They did go out like they were supposed to, like they were encouraged to do, and they collected the various olive and myrtle and palm branches, and they built these tent-like things on the roof of their homes, in their courtyards, and in the courts of the temple. And verses 17 and 18 then say that their joy was very great. Day after day, Ezra read to them from God's holy word, and they celebrated the feast. So it sounds like a citywide campout with feasting and with reading sessions, and I think I could get into that and enjoy that. And it also sounds like their obedience led to joy. Jesus connects as he's praying for his disciples and for those that will follow him after them. When he prays over his people in John 14, 15, 16, 17, and talks with them, he emphasizes obedience, and he emphasizes oneness, and he emphasizes joy and the connection between all of them. John 17 says that he wants us to have the full measure of our joy with him. And you know, I'm pretty sure that joy isn't based on what we would think of as happy emotions. I think it's non-circumstantial joy. Non-circumstantial joy is a joy that can't be eroded by the ups and downs of life. So day by day, they read God's word. Their faith was renewed, was reaffirmed, and they celebrated the feast. So I'd like for us to listen now to a song that has helped many people, including myself, be reaffirmed in my faith, and it's called He is Worthy. And then after that, I'll close us in prayer.
Do you feel the world is broken? We do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. But do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? We do. Do you wish that you could see it all made new? We do.
That's great.
And is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? The Lion of Judah. who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. Does the Father truly love us? Does the Spirit move among us?
Yeah.
And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves?
Yeah.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Sing with me. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slain. From every people and tribe, from every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of this? He is. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? He is. He is.
Let's do pray as we close now. Lord Jesus, we worship you because you are worthy. You are the living word. You're our shelter and you're our protection. You're the festival and the feast, and you are our joy and our strength. We pray that our hearts, our faith would be renewed today and that our priorities would be transformed. And we pray this in the power of your holy name. Amen. God bless you in your table time.